I passed the AWS Solutions Architect Professional Recertification Exam. This exam was brutal. I think it was harder now than it was 3 years ago, even though I now have 3 more years of experience. I'll tell you how I did it. I believe you must study everything that you can. That means AWS documentation, read white papers, take practice exams. I have never passed the practice exam. More on that later. Read customer scenarios. Get online training through A-Cloud Guru, Linux Academy. Now they're the same, but somebody. Udemy courses, INE. And the number one thing for me is hands-on, drink coffee. Hands-on labs, drink coffee. Do more labs, drink more coffee. You get it. First, I want to talk about the exam logistics. This was my first time taking a proctored exam through Pearson VUE. It was a very different experience. Even though it was nerve-wracking, they are very helpful in getting you set up. Part of the information they send after you schedule the exam says, "We want your online proctored exam experience to be as trouble-free as possible. That's why Pearson VUE ensures that a proctor will check you in and monitor the exam, and the software will be ready to deliver your exam. We also need you to be prepared and know what to expect." I will say that they are very helpful if you read all the details beforehand. Do not skip all these details. To start off, I had to install the test-taking software, and I had to run systems tests to make sure that my laptop will work the day of the exam. I am so OCD, I ran the system test at least 10 times from the day I scheduled my exam. And I ran this system test on different computers and different spots in my house because I wasn't 100% sure which laptop I would use and in which part of the house I would take the exam. OCD at its finest, I know. Depending on your logistics, this might not be a bad idea. Is your spouse working from home too? Are your kids doing online classes? The proctor clearly told me, if anyone walks in on your exam, you automatically fail. This made me extremely nervous. I did not like the idea of taking the test from home. More on this later on in this video. One final note, check out what Pearson VUE included in an email 3 days before the exam. I quote, "Benjamin Franklin once said, 'An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.' It's in this spirit that we recommend you take the time to complete the steps above before you take your exam. And remember, if you still have difficulties with online proctoring, feel free to schedule an exam at one of our testing centers. Please follow those instructions. Make sure that not only your brain is ready, but also your work area, your family, pets, computer, internet, and everything else is ready." The AWS Solutions Architect Professional is known as one of the most difficult IT certifications to pass. Actually, any of the professional level cloud certifications are excruciatingly difficult. The exam tests your ability to architect solutions on all AWS technologies in ways you might not be used to. AWS suggests that you have at least 2 years of experience to attempt this exam. I suggest many more years on the job experience for this certificate to actually mean something. More on this later in this video. For me, there are certain topics on the exam that are easier and topics that make the test very hard. For example, as a network engineer with over 20 years experience, anything that has to do with IP addressing, subnet mask, routing, BGP, VPCs is a cakewalk. As a security engineer for international institutions, anything with firewalls, WAFs, security groups, NACLs is also a piece of cake. My difficulties come on the development side as I have no programming experience. Therefore, anything where I have to script changes, write code, etc., will be a huge challenge for me. That's where I focus my studies. And truth be told, I will never be a great programmer. There is just such a different mindset between the two camps that I haven't met anyone great at both. You might have the opposite problem. Loads of development, programming experience, and no networking, security, or server knowledge. Focus your attention on your weaknesses. One thing I love about the AWS exams is that they are based on real-life scenarios. Imagine yourself as an architect and how you are going to solve the problem by applying AWS best practices in a well-architected framework. In comparison, I remember taking the CCIE lab years ago and just being reminded over and over again, this is not the real world. For me, it's difficult to take an exam that is not based on the real world. What's the point of testing something if I will never use that knowledge? It might have changed now. For now, I don't care about it and I don't keep up to date on it. In all my years of experience, I can say that AWS exams are on point and based on reality. Obviously, there are things I don't work on, but there is literally no one that works on everything that AWS has to offer. So here are the steps taken to pass the AWS Certified Solutions Architect Professional Recertification. Online training. Right off the bat, I will say that no course alone is enough to pass. That's right. They are still valuable and can be the foundation of your exam prep. I used a Cloud Guru, Linux Academy, Udemy, INE, and anything else I could find online. The AWS reInvent sessions provide a lot of guidance and they are all available for free. I would say to watch as many of those as you can. They have a lot of customers speak about a problem they were facing, why they chose a particular solution to resolve this problem, how they implemented this AWS solution, and how they plan on improving that solution. That really helps me think about my customers' needs, which in turn helps for the exam. Here's a few more points to keep in mind. Some of these online training sites can be costly. If your budget is very low, then create a playlist of tutorials found on YouTube. You can search for just about every topic. For me, I prefer to focus on the thinking process and on actually building something. The videos on theory are great, but putting that theory into practice is better. If you have very little or no experience, I would make this an ultimate goal that you achieve in the next few years. That will give you enough time to really understand the videos and online classes and time to build and test everything you have learned. I will not purchase videos that I cannot play at 2x the speed. Yeah, I'm weird like that. But if you're planning on selling videos and you're watching this, please ensure that I could speed them up or else I'm not buying them. There are some training services out there that only allow you to view the video at the speed it was recorded. I absolutely cannot learn like that and will not purchase. Now, you might have the opposite issue and need to slow down some of the videos in order to grasp what is being said, especially if it's not available in your native language. You have to do what works for you. I took training in 3 languages. Although English is my mother tongue, it's interesting how the same lesson can provide new understanding in another language. Plus, I work with customers that are not native English speakers. I have to be able to express myself in a language they understand. If you haven't noticed by now, you really have to be customer focused. And here's another interesting point. Do something else while you are learning. Yeah, this is another weird one. But it is something I picked up from taking instructor-led language courses. It's a method where you do something physical, like throw a ball while trying to memorize phrases in another language. The physical act of throwing the ball can create a useful mind association. I don't know if it works, but hey, I pass. didn't I? Twice. Read AWS documentation and AWS FAQs. AWS changes all the time. New features are added constantly. I mean, the dashboard doesn't even look the same from a year ago. I subscribe to the RSS feed of all AWS announcements. I push that to my Slack account. And I gotta tell you, it is nonstop daily action. It is a consistent flow of bite-sized knowledge for your brain. It's better to study consistently than to try to cram everything in a few days. Remember that these updates can be on the exam 6 months after the service or feature is GA. I will say that this feed was invaluable to my preparation, and it is this feed that makes me build and test everything that comes out new. Read the well-architected framework white paper. As most of the questions are based on these design principles, this framework is what helps in designing highly available, fault-tolerant, and secure systems. I wouldn't say it's the end-all be-all, but it helps in designing. They are guiding principles, but you just can't throw them around willy-nilly. It's like the Six Sigma and Agile methodologies. They mean nothing if they aren't saving or generating money, if they aren't making your customers' business better. Sometimes it just gets in the way of progress. At the end of the day, all that matters to your customers is that their enterprise succeeds, whether that is a vertical that saves lives or just generates money. Practice exams. Here too, my strategy is way different in that I have never passed a practice exam. You heard that right. I have never passed a practice exam. I guess I just can't take it seriously. I don't like taking exams, and it is really hard for me to budget 3 hours to take a practice exam. And because I know that it is a practice exam, I don't eliminate the distractions you normally would in the real exam. I mean, my mobile phone is right next to me. I'm responding to messages, checking out social media. I'm taking calls from my customers. I get up to use the restroom. I go to the kitchen for an espresso every 10 minutes. All these things that you can't do on exam day. For those reasons, I believe I have never passed a practice exam. Some candidates have the time and patience to take these exams and need this self-assessment before they feel confident enough to take the real exam. But how many practice exams can you take? In 3 hours, you can build a very nice cloud infrastructure and learn a whole lot more. I took the official practice exams, some of the Linux Academy practice exams, and the AWS sample questions. I use these to gauge my thought process more than anything. Passing the AWS Solution Architect Professional exam is all about how you think when a customer has specific requirements. For example, embedded deep into the scenario, it might say that the solution has to be low cost. So although solution A is probably the best answer, if the question asks for the ultimate design, it is the worst answer when cost is concerned. I recommend that as you get closer to the exam date, you take some practice exams, but I do not recommend taking the same practice exam over and over again because then you just develop muscle memory. Some candidates take these over and over until they score 100% and then they fail the real exam. They wonder why. Taking practice exams does not teach you how to think. You should take these practice exams so that you know how hard a test will be and also to understand the format of the test. It stinks to go to the real exam not knowing what to expect. And the number one thing to do that I did to prepare for the exam is hands-on. Do not skip or skimp the hands-on labs. If you have been following my channel, you know that I believe that using AWS is the best way to learn AWS. Build it, break it, fix it, modify it, rinse, repeat. I mean, if this isn't fun and exciting for you, then do something else. To me, this is like the best video game ever, and it doesn't cost much to play. Build something, anything, and tear it down. It's that simple. Back in the day when I was learning Cisco networking, I spent about $20,000 on networking equipment. Yes, $20,000. I remember even back-to-back cables used to cost $75 each, and you needed 10 to 20 of them. And even that wasn't enough to build an enterprise-level network, so I had to rent rack time. Anyone remember that? Please post a comment down below. I recall having to pay something like $20 for a block of 4 hours, and I had to schedule it way ahead of time, like weeks ahead of time, and it was usually at some odd hour, like 2 in the morning to 6 in the morning. I still did it because it was fun for me, and I wanted to be good at it. But even those rack rentals did not come close to what an enterprise network looks like. At best, it looked like a small business with 6 to 8 locations running protocols they didn't need to. With cloud environments, in this case AWS, you can build a world-class infrastructure that can generate a customer millions of dollars with only a few bucks. If you find the hands-on approach to be too tedious, then I don't know what to say. I recommend using your own account for hands-on practice because it teaches you to be conscious of your spending. One of the biggest issues with using a corporate account is that you probably never get to see how much you spend. For an enterprise, a $100 expense is nothing and will probably go undetected. But if it came out of your pocket, you would definitely feel it. In order to pass the exam, you have to know how to save money. For example, something so simple as a multi-AZ RDS instance versus single AZ instance can double your expenses. For me, I need to feel the pain of spending that money for it to become ingrained in my brain that if a question calls for low cost, I know I have to pick single AZ. Same thing goes with spot instances versus on-demand versus reserved instances. This is an exercise that I do over and over again. Pretend you are the customer and set a budget. Because it's just you, say something very low, $5, $10, or $20 for the month. Now build something staying within that budget. This may sound ridiculous to you, because it's just for yourself. But that small budget would easily go into the millions of dollars per month if your customer has thousands of users. For example, if you were to provision Amazon workspaces, how would you ensure that you don't go over budget? Another reason I use my own account, and I recommend that you use your own development account if you have multiple, is to see that things that you normally would not see on a corporate account. The larger the enterprise, the less you get to see on your AWS account. Sounds like the opposite is true, but it's not. For example, when I have worked on very large enterprises, I rarely get to see the full IAM configuration for the organization. Usually, IAM ends up being managed by non-technical or not very technical administrative staff. Once again, it seems that the opposite would be true, but usually it's not. So what ends up happening is that you never get to see the ins and outs of managing IAM from the top down. Every organization has restrictions. Every organization will limit you in some way. If you use your own accounts, and I say accounts, because you need multiple accounts to really understand scenarios. If you use your own accounts, you will be able to manage every single minute detail unencumbered. Now back to the online proctored exam. Why did I not like the idea of taking the test at home? There are at least two big issues for me. One, you are not allowed any paper during the online proctored exam. There is an electronic note-taking app, but you have to close it and open it, or else it just sits on top of the exam. For me, it was totally useless. I typed something in there and never went back. The biggest issue for me is that I need a pen and paper to take notes of challenging questions. It's this mechanical process that helps me chew the question a little bit. With paper, you can take a quick glance at these notes if another question pops up that sort of helps you answer a previous one. Another reason is quite obvious. Who in their right mind calls themselves an architect without drawing something out on paper or on a chalkboard? There are always scenarios where you just have to draw the flow of your network. Drawing out what happens between point A and point B is a crucial part of everyday cloud architecture, engineering, and troubleshooting. It felt like having one hand tied behind my back. Another thing I did not like is that you cannot say a single word. You can't even move your lips. I tend to read in a low voice all the scenarios, and I sort of have to talk to myself, moving my hands as if repeating the issue to a customer and then coming up with the solution. You can't do that here while online practicing. So you have to build everything in your head, which was very hard for me. My attention deficit gets the best of me after 3 seconds. These two points made it extremely difficult for me. Many of the questions are several sentences in length, and then you have to read several possible answers that are each several sentences long. One final note that only became evident during the exam is that the camera light is on, meaning they are recording you. You are also looking at yourself in a small window that says recording, sort of like what you see in Zoom if you only want to see yourself as the speaker. That was very annoying and distracting. If you are OCD with a hefty sprinkle of ADHD, you will have a hard time. But hey, I did it, and I biggie-sized my ADHD. Now, what did I like about taking the tests at home? For one, I got to use my personal laptop, one that I am comfortable with, my own mouse and keyboard. I studied and took practice exams and did labs hands-on in the same chair, table, and location in my house. This might not be a big deal for you, but every time I have taken an exam at one of the testing centers, something has thrown me off. The desk was tiny. The mouse was not as responsive or fast as I like. The monitor resolution was very low. The chair did not adjust the way I like. This is a 3-hour exam with check-in and final survey. This is more like 3.5 hours. An uncomfortable chair will be brutal. Your expensive gaming chair will make the whole process a little more pleasant. I use my most comfortable chair, the one I can sit on for hours. Another thing I really liked, and this one made my day, I quote, "A beverage in any container is allowed." Wow, being without water or coffee that long is very unpleasant for me. You are not allowed anything when you take the exam in person at a testing center. So this was a huge plus. But be careful drinking too much. You are not allowed to use the restroom during your exam. If you get up to use the restroom, you automatically fail. To wrap up, I think experience and the ability to deliver is the only thing that matters. A certification is just a piece of paper, or now PDF. The best architects I know don't have a single certification, and they run circles around me. With that said, cloud certifications are in high demand and are based on real-life scenarios. To me, that makes it worth pursuing. Out of all the exams I have taken throughout my career, pro-level cloud certifications like the AWS Solutions Architect Professional are without a doubt the hardest exams around. I almost forgot to mention something. One final thing I do is a little biohacking trick I learned years ago, and I do this before every single exam. Now, here's a disclaimer. I don't experience ill effects from doing this. Your mileage may vary. I'm not recommending anything that may put your health at risk. Check with your doctor first. Don't do this unless you know how you will feel. With that said, I practice fasting from the evening before until after I have taken the test. I basically stop eating at around 7 or 8 p.m. the night before the test. I always schedule my exams for around 9 or 9:30 a.m. I believe it creates a huge surge of alertness and concentration right when I need it the most, which is around the halfway mark into the exam. And fasting for me means absolutely no calories, only water, black coffee, with no cream, no sugar, no fat. Like I said, it works for me. I end up mega focused and in tune to my inner AWS architect. Like I said, once again, your mileage may vary, but try it for a practice exam and see how you feel. Now, you don't have to listen to anything I say or do, but I have passed this exam twice, 3 years ago, and now my AWS Certified Solutions Architect Professional Certification is good to go for the next 3 years until 2024. Next up, I have to recertify the Microsoft Certified Azure Solutions Architect Expert Certification. I will be posting a video on this soon. Till next time.